So this talk is inspired by my own personal experiences of living with autoimmune diseases for nearly 3 decades and my involvement in animal rights and vegan activism for nearly 2 decades. And it's also informed by theories of oppression, a literature on animal rights and disability studies. I should also note that I'm certainly not a disability scholar, and I'm finding my way in the many different theories on disability as well. And exploring the topics in this paper has raised many questions for me, and I really don't pretend to have all the answers on them. But so this has been a journey of exploration for me too, and that is perhaps also the biggest purpose of my talk, that I hope that it will make you consider the interconnections between different sorts of oppression, including ableism and ageism, and that you will recognize examples of ableism and ageism, and that you will acknowledge the need for diversity and inclusion in the movement. So I will start with some definitions. Two definitions of ableism to give you an idea. Discrimination or prejudice against disabled people in favor of those considered to be able-bodied. Another definition from stopableism.org is the practices and dominant attitudes in society that devalue and limit the potential of persons with disabilities. It's a set of practices and beliefs that assign inferior value or worth to people who have developmental, emotional, physical, or psychiatric disabilities. Definition of ageism, prejudice or discrimination on the ground of a person's age. Or another definition, prejudice or discrimination against a particular age group and especially the elderly. So I'm just giving definitions of ageism and ableism. I won't be giving a definition of speciesism, as this is an animal rights conference, and I suppose that everybody here knows what speciesism is about. Sexism and racism and other isms are also generally well understood, but ageism and ableism are lesser known, and so that's why I want to start the presentation with the definitions and give some examples. So from these definitions, it should become immediately clear that ableism is very strongly connected to ageism, as older people in general have declining abilities, which comes naturally with the aging process. Some examples to make it more concrete. The representation or non-representation in popular culture of disabled and older people. So on the right, you see an example that's a screenshot of a newspaper article that went viral a couple of weeks ago, and it was especially shared in a lot of metal groups. And the general tendency was, oh, so cute, those old men, they wanted to go to a metal festival. Oh, good for them that they want to have some fun. You know, it was really seen as cute and what was more found funny. But actually, the story behind it was that it was two 60-year-old men who have a mental disability and who live in a care facility, who just took the bus. They are free to take the bus, and they went to the town where the metal festival is held, and they had a little bit to drink that evening, and they missed the last bus, and so the police had to take them home. So, but all the media framed it as, oh, the elderly men, they escaped their nursing home. So often we see that patronizing language is used, seeing older people as cute, as sweet, or thinking older people doing something associated with younger people is adorable or is surprising. Another example, also about representations of older people and disabled people in popular culture, the Disney cartoon. This is by Alexandro Palombo, and he wants to point to the fact that, for example, in Disney movies, you never see disabled persons. And when disabled people, when they do fit in a plot of a movie, they are often played by an able-bodied actor, while there are many disabled actors around who could play that part. And also the villains or bad guys in movies often have visible disabilities. Think, for example, of the one-eyed or one-legged pirate. Also, older people are often portrayed in TV shows as frail, as forgetful, as slow. And sometimes there's also an added layer of sexism here. Older men are then more portrayed as wise, as experienced, while older women are more portrayed as being a burden, as nagging, and as a nuisance. So another example of ableism and ageism is ableist and ageist language. So just like you have racist language and sexist language, there's also a thing like ageist and ableist language. Examples of ageist language can be, like I said, seeing them as adorable, calling older people over the hill, referring to older ladies as the blue hairs. For example, when you meet a group of older women, you meet them as "hello, young ladies." That's actually quite patronizing, calling older people grandpa, an old fart, or prune. Examples of ableist language are terms like retarded, lame, insane, calling people an idiot, a loony, referring to somebody or something that somebody said as being so autistic or being crippled or being a spaz. Another example is, of course, what comes to mind perhaps in the first instance for people is accessibility for disabled people. Now, this is a very ironic example that you have to ask for the wheelchair ramp inside. Of course, yeah, it's ironic because you cannot get inside to go ask for the ramp. Then we have microaggressions and little jokes. Now, microaggressions are not really discrimination in themselves, but you could compare them, for example, with a mosquito bite. If you have one mosquito bite a day, it's not really that bothersome. It won't really bother you that much. But if you get 20 mosquito bites in the day, at the end of the day, you say, well, that was super annoying. Well, that's a bit, you can compare that a bit with the microaggressions. And this was a drawing that I found from Courtney, who occasionally uses a wheelchair like I do, so I can relate to a lot of the microaggressions that she spells out there. And I think it's too little for you to read, but a couple of examples are, for example, that people then say, but you can walk, right? I saw you walk, I saw you move your legs. Or people just move your wheelchair without telling you something because you're in the way or something. So that's not really discrimination in itself, but all those little things add up at the end of the day. So disabled and older people are more at risk of being physically, sexually, psychologically, and financially abused. Disabled and older people are more at risk of being are more vulnerable to neglect. Older people are at higher risk of living in poverty, and that's even more the case for women, disabled people, and women of color. Stereotypes. The stereotype that all old people get sick and have disabilities, that older people are incapable of learning anything new, that older people and disabled people are often assumed to be frail or dependent and seen as a burden to society. Then there's also, of course, institutionalized ableism and ageism. We have, for example, the healthcare system health insurance system, where many people are excluded on the basis of abilities, for example, pre-existing conditions, or are excluded on the basis of age. If you're older, it's much more difficult to get the proper health insurance. Then, for example, also mandatory retirement age. In a lot of countries, you have to retire at 65 or 66 or whatever age. That's really discriminatory against older people if you would still want to work. There was also something, this is a particular example of institutionalized ableism. There was something called the ugly laws, and that was in the 19th century and also still in the 20th century in the United States. So there were laws in certain US cities banning people who were deemed diseased, maimed, mutilated, or in any way deformed so as to be an unsightly or disgusting object or improper person. So they were banned from public spaces. Now, the reason behind this was not really aesthetic, but it was really about controlling disabled people so they would have a means to be able to arrest them and to put them in institutions where they could actually control the disabled people. And the reasoning behind this also goes together with the whole eugenetic movement. And in this period, there was also, for example, the the forced sterilization of people with disabilities, being a part of the eugenetics movement. So, and this didn't only pertain to people with mental disabilities, but for example, also blind people, deaf people were forced sterilized. Another example of institutionalized ableism was the killing of people with disabilities during the Holocaust, and also medical experiments that were performed on disabled people against their will. Now, a central notion of ableism and ageism is, of course, that their bodies, our bodies, are deemed not productive, not useful, not marketable. They are of no use in a system that is centered around production and profit. Another thing that I would really like to mention, I've mentioned it before, is that there are intersections with other isms, of course. I will touch upon the intersection with speciesism later. But for example, with sexism and racism, women and people of color are not believed or are generally less believed by the medical facility, by the medical professions when they are in pain, which, for example, leads to later diagnosis or misdiagnosis. Ageism affects women earlier than men. Women are considered as older, perhaps already at 35 or at 40, while for men that's at a later age. And so other oppressions add another layer also on the neglect, abuse, and institutionalized discrimination. So for people of color, that applies for women, for LGBTQ, and for poor people. So that's the aspect of classicism. And the last thing that I wanted to note as an introduction is that I will also check your internalized ableism and ageism. So for people with disabilities or older people themselves, internalized ableism and ageism is when people with disabilities and older people themselves think that they are of no value, that they are not good enough, and that they think they have nothing to contribute or are redundant because the system makes them think that way. So about the intersections, the first part, intersections between ableism, ageism, and speciesism. This is a photo from a photo book by Amanda Jones about it always shows a photo of a dog when he or she was young and then at a later age. So this is Fred at 2 years and then later at 10 years. And a similar book is by Pete Thorne, Old Faithful, Dogs of a Certain Age. Now, despite the special attention to older dogs, we see that older and disabled animal companions have less chance of getting adopted. They face a much greater chance of being killed or euthanized than younger dogs because it is difficult to find adopters for them due to their shorter additional life expectancy and to unknown veterinary costs. And some shelters do not even accept animals over a certain age. Now, I did not find any examples of photo books dedicated to older sheep or older horses or cows or chickens. Not even about cats, maybe they are, but I didn't find any. So here's an element of speciesism maybe as well. About the natural life expectancy of farm animals, this is a chart by School of Vegan. I think many of you who are active online will have seen this chart before. So it gives the lifespan of farm animals. And they, of course, they hardly ever reach old age. We have the company of sheep ourselves at home, and we've had veterinarians come over the years to take care of sheep and the other animals that we take care of. And none of the vets that we have come over actually know what the natural life expectancy of sheep is because they have never have dealt with sheep that are so old. So everything that happens to the sheep is new for them. They are starting to lose their teeth and everything. So it's because they never encounter sheep that are so old. By the way, the sheep that we have now living with us are 16 years. So that's even a couple of years older than is noted in the chart of School of Vegan, which says that the natural life expectancy is 12 years. Another thing that I would like to note about this is that killing of animals at a young age is often brought up as an argument to show how cruel animal agriculture is. But actually, no matter what the age, whether it's an animal that is 2 months old or 2 years old or 20 years old, killing animals is always wrong. And I think that should be the message and not really the age of the animals. About broiler chickens, this is a photo from Animal Rights Netherlands. Now, a lot of animals don't even show up in animal agriculture or slaughter statistics because disabled animals are most often immediately killed after birth, after being born, or they are killed when getting disabilities later on or get sick, or they just get neglected and they are left to die, which happens with broiler chickens, of course. So this is not only the case for farmed animals, but also for animal companions, because as I noted before, they cost too much and they need too much care. Also for animals used in experiments, because disabled animals could possibly distort the results. And also, for example, in animals in zoos and entertainment, because nobody wants to see a crippled lion. And again, one of the issues here is, of course, productivity. And after a certain age, productivity drops. And there's also the intersection with sexism here, because female reproductiveness is a central part in animal agro industry. The females need to produce offspring, they need to lay eggs, they need to produce milk. And when productivity or reproductivity drops, they are no longer economically profitable. Now, luckily, some disabled or older animals are fortunate to be rescued and spend their lives at sanctuaries. This is, for example, Sheep 64 at Edgar's Mission. That's a sanctuary in the US. So Sheep 64 is blind and gets around with the help of another sheep who's carrying a bell and also with a metal halo, so that when he bumps into a wall, he doesn't bump in with his head, but the halo warns him that he is about to bump into something. Now, who is actually considered as disabled? I will give two examples to make the point. Here on the left, we see a cat in a wheelchair. This cat was shot and paralyzed and then was rescued and, as you can see, given a wheelchair. And on the right-hand side, you see flat-faced cats. So those are called brachycephalic cats, and they often have breathing problems, eye inflammation, skin infections, and difficulty eating. So the general perception is that the cat on the left would be seen as disabled, but we don't generally think of the cats on the right with a flat face as disabled, although they have a lot of health issues because of selective breeding that has taken part, of course. A similar example is here with the cows. On the left, we have a cow. This was calf called Hero. He had suffered from frostbite and had parts of his back legs removed, amputated because of the frostbite. And he was then rescued and given prosthetic legs. And on the right, we have the famous Belgian Blue. I guess you've all heard of that special example from my country, I'm ashamed to say. These cows have been naturally selected for double muscling. And in a lot of cases, they cannot give birth naturally. They need a cesarean section. They have joint problems because of the large body mass, of course. And for example, also from the calves, the large tongue can cause drinking problems. So again, who is seen as disabled? The general perception will be that the calf with the prosthetic legs will be seen as disabled, while in fact, we could also say that the Belgian Blue is a disabled cows. So the definition of ableism talks about the discrimination of disabled people, the definition that I gave in the beginning, but it did not say anything about who falls into the category of who is considered disabled and who is not considered disabled. And so in disability theory, there's generally the idea that it's a combination of two things. Disabled is the interaction between, on the one side, functional limitation, and on the other side, an environment that does not take into account these differences or limitations. So on the one side, you have the medical model of disability that really puts the focus on the individual. So the individual needs to integrate, the individual needs to put in an effort to adapt, the individual must do his best or her best. Versus, on the other hand, the social model of disability, which more puts the focus on society. Society needs to adapt. Society needs to provide accessible spaces and facilities. So if you would for example, take the social model to its extreme. The social model would say, we have disabled people because this society makes disabled people, because society doesn't put enough effort in it to provide an accessible environment for disabled people. So it is important to realize that disability or ability is partly a social construction, and who is labeled as disabled or abled varies according to time, place, and also varies culturally. Some other intersections on between ableism, ageism, and speciesism is, for example, the impact of animal agro-industry on environment and health. For example, people living near the agricultural businesses who experience health problems because of water pollution, because of the air quality. And of course, the impact of animal-based diet on health, cheap food, often being animal-based foods, unhealthy foods. So that's also, there's also an intersection with classism here. And another aspect, the psychological and physical toll on slaughterhouse workers. So the system depends on cheap labor and exploits not only animals, but also humans. Now I want to give some more a framework about the interconnections between all of these oppressions. All of these oppressions and other oppressions like racism, sexism, and classism are interconnected. But these oppressions do not simply intersect. They operate in the same way and use the same tactics of objectification, animalization, devaluation, and putting the blame for problems on the others. So this fits into the Western way of thinking that categorizes the world in binaries or dualisms, in which one end is always valued higher than the other. So we have male against female, human against and higher as other animals, white against people of color, rational against emotional, culture as higher than nature, able, disabled, young, old, and straight or hetero against LGBTQ. And belonging to a category on the left or on the right side means either benefiting from privilege or respectively being in the oppressed group. And the categories in one side, so on the left or on the right, also get linked together. So for example, men are thought of as more rational, women are categorized as more emotional, people of color are seen as closer to nature and animal-like, and this also applies to disabled people, for example, calling disabled people animal names and seeing them as animals. And I have an example here of Julia Pastrana. She was called the ape woman, the bear woman, the baboon woman. She had a medical condition called hypertrichosis, which caused extra hair all over her hair growth all over her body. And she took part in the so-called freak shows that were touring Europe and the United States in the 19th century and still into the 20th century. So she died in 1860, and she was only 26, a couple of days after giving childbirth, after having a baby. And her body and that of the baby was embalmed and was taken for several years still after her death and being embalmed on tour, being part as these freak shows. So this was in the same period and often took place together with the tours of animal menageries, which traveled with exotic animals across the US and Europe. And in this period, and also well into the 20th century, we also had the so-called human zoos, in which humans from exotic places were put on display and they traveled across Europe and the United States. So this is an example, an illustration of the interconnections between ableism, sexism, speciesism, and of course, racism. Another note on the interconnectedness of ableism and speciesism is that ableism is, of course, strongly connected to speciesism, because speciesism is in se ableism, because it is discrimination of other animals because they do not possess certain abilities. This is the book by Sonara Taylor, Beasts of Burden, and if you would like to find out more about these interconnections between speciesism and ableism, I would definitely recommend you pick up this book. So throughout history, several abilities have been the demarcation line to give moral status to some and to deny it to others. Being able to speak, being able to reason, eyes that face forward, walking on two legs. So this also had implications not only for other animals, for non-human animals, but also for the humans who do not possess those abilities, who cannot speak, who cannot see, who cannot reason. They were and are still seen as less human. Now, a final note on the interconnections between these oppressions is that these isms or these oppressions are often seen as individual prejudices, as individual discrimination or individual biases, but they are in fact ideologies developed to enforce a system of oppression. Discriminating against older people or disabled people is portrayed by the system as the natural way of things. For example, older people or disabled people, just as other marginalized groups, are blamed for economic and social challenges. Another thought that is always brought up is that there is not enough money to take care of older people or disabled people, that there is not enough money for healthcare. But of course there is enough money. That's not true that there is not enough money. It is a question of how the money is used and who possesses the money and how wealth is distributed. And that's a choice that we make as a society. So these oppressions are ideologies to support and legitimize the oppression of women, of disabled people, of older people, of all others who are seen as unproductive and to keep the system going. Now, what is then the source of the system of oppression? Now, some authors stress one aspect more than the other. For me, personally, being informed by aspects from ecofeminism, environmental justice, intersectionality, and social justice, I see it as a mixture of capitalism, colonialism, and patriarchy, and a combination of all of these all reinforcing one another. So the important note to take with you about that is activism should not only be about changing individual behavior, but about dismantling the system of oppression. So that includes being aware of all the connections between these different isms, between these different oppressions. Tackling just one of these oppressions, for example, if you take out speciesism and only tackle speciesism, without taking into account the other oppressions, racism, sexism, ableism, ageism, so while colluding with the system, that will not work. So that was about the intersections. This is the second part, which I will only briefly glance over because there's also a lot of overlap with the third section, how to effectively reach older people and people with disabilities in our activism. Listen to marginalized groups. So the approach of disabled people and older people to veganism, to animal rights, their questions and concerns might be totally different than those of younger people or able-bodied people. So if possible, let them be actively involved in campaigns targeting their peers. And if possible, let them lead the campaigns. I say if possible, because for some people with some disabilities, this might be a bit more difficult. The format of the media that you use in your activism. Be aware that not everybody can listen to podcasts, can actually see or read blogs, can see photos. So, for example, with photos, add image descriptions, add subtitles to your videos, add transcripts of the podcasts, provide translations, maybe also in sign language. Also, be aware that different types of activism appeal more or less to different age groups. For example, online activism, be aware of the age reach when you are announcing an event through the sole medium of Facebook. About the time, place, and location of activism. Think about which types of events will reach older people, will reach people with disabilities. Be aware, for example, that a potluck in the park, which involves sitting in the grass, may not be accessible for everyone. There's also about the time slot. Be aware that there's a difference between activities during the day versus in the evening, which will appeal more or less to some people. And I already mentioned language use, so don't use ableist language or ageist language. Use language that is respectful to all ages and to disabled people. And if you want to read more about, this is a book from Carol Adams, Patty Braidman, and Ginny Messina, Especially focused on reaching people that are over 50 years old, the over 50 guide to adopting and thriving on a plant-based diet. So thirdly, about being an inclusive movement. Is there ageism and ableism in the vegan and animal rights movement? Well, that's more like a rhetorical question, because yes, I think there is. This is a quote from Collectively Free from an interview with Carol Adams. When we open a vegan brochure, we are most likely met with images of stereotypical, able-bodied, youthful, happy people who are also usually white and heteronormative. Veganism is then portrayed as a life-prolonging cure-all in the same way as anti-aging beauty brands market their products, reinforcing the idea that more age equals less beauty, less health, and less ability. So I want to ask, it's more like a rhetorical question. Where are the older people from the movement? Where are the older voices? Where are the people who were already active in the 70s and 80s in animal rights activism? And they do exist. Are they here? Okay, thank you. So if you go to vegan festivals, to conferences, if you look around at events during demonstrations, do you see diversity? If you look around, I see a very white audience in front of me. So that's also an aspect that we should take into consideration. I had a video here. I don't know whether the sound is working, but anyway, if it's not working, I will explain. This is a video from Plant-Based News, and it shows some images from a BBC documentary from in the 70s about veganism, and it then shows some images about veganism now. So the sound is probably not working, but that was the BBC documentary in the 70s. Like any documentary in the 70s from the BBC, it was quite dull. Yeah? But and that is then how plant-based news shows vegans now. All very able-bodied, young people, six-packs. And then again, the documentary from the BBC, which was with a rather dull voice. And the images of the veganism now are shown with a very exciting and hip music with it. So the contrast is really, really big. So I don't have anything about against vegans with six packs. I just want to, but it's just to make a point about the contrast here. So I think this video shows some respect for the pioneers of the movement, and it actually ridicules them a bit. I would have loved to see a video where the older voices of the movement would have been given a chance to say something. So it also gives a misrepresentation of who vegans actually are. They are not all six-packed bodybuilding young athletes. So it indirectly also involves some body shaming and ageism. And also in this video, the message of animal rights, what veganism isn't essentially about, is completely missing here. So some points to take into account to be an inclusive movement with respect to ableism and ageism. Don't say veganism is easy, because that is not true for everyone. It does not pay attention to the many oppressed or marginalized groups who do not have easy access to fresh food, to vegan products and services. For example, people who are institutionalized in nursing homes, in care facilities, in hospital, but I also think about prisoners, for example, or people who depend on others for living, for shopping, for food. For them, it might be more difficult. I have an example for rules of a nursing home close to where I live, that only provides an alternative diet with a prescription from a doctor. So if you're an ethical vegan, you cannot expect to get a vegan food there. So also, for example, people who depend on ready-made meals, or if you live in an area where ready-made meals are not available vegan, that might be more difficult for you. About activism, stop shaming activists for not being present at rallies, at demonstrations, or other events. Activism comes in many forms. I feel there is so much focus in the movement on street activism and on people doing the most visible forms of activism, who are then proclaimed the heroes of the movement. But there are many invisible forms of activism too. Another point, body shaming. Stop the body shaming. Body shaming in the movement mostly comes down to fat shaming, shaming people for being fat, but vegans come in all sizes and shapes. On average, yes, vegans do have a lower BMI, but that does not mean all vegans are thin, and a vegan diet is no guarantee for weight loss. There are also healthy obese people, and there are unhealthy skinny people. There is no one-to-one causal relation with respect to many diseases. So the problems with fat shaming are that it marginalizes fat vegans inside the movement, it makes them feel unwelcome in the movement, and also it is not effective. Body shaming is not only counterproductive, but it can even be damaging to mental health. It can contribute to the development of eating disorders, give people a negative self-image, and adds to dropped self-esteem. So, for example, here the about the donkeys in Santorini. This was a message that went viral over the summer. And that photo on the right of the lady is a photo that's been used over the years many, many times. And that's actually not in Santorini, but I believe it is in Jordan, where they also have donkey rights. If you put out an image like that, the focus is not on the animal rights issue, but it's about shaming fat people. And it gives an implicit message from, if we could just have the fat people not on the donkeys and only skinny people, then the problem would be solved. But that doesn't solve the problem. If we want to, the focus should be animal rights and just saying we need to stop these practices of using donkeys. Skinny people, thin people, or fat people, that doesn't matter. It just has to stop. So I have a quote here, I found this quote somewhere, but I don't know anymore from who it is, so I'm sorry, but I'm using your quote. Being vegan is what is in our hearts, not what is in our hips. So that's about body shaming. Okay, thank you. Related to this is, of course, health shaming. Stop the health shaming. So that's shaming people about their health status. Veganism is often presented as a miracle cure for all health problems, like go vegan and all your health problems will be solved. But there are so many other factors that determine one's health. So not only diet plays a part for your health, but also lifestyle, environmental factors, where you live. Think of air pollution, water pollution, radiation in your area. And of course, there's also genetics. And most often, there's no one-to-one link between any of these and health status. So I'm certainly not denying that a vegan diet and certainly a whole foods plant-based diet is generally beneficial to one's health and can reduce the risk for many chronic conditions and illnesses. For example, vegans are less likely to have type 2 diabetes, have hypertension, or develop certain cancers. But there is no guarantee. Even vegans can get cancer. Yes, even the whole food plant-based vegans. Even vegans die. There's a book also from Carol Adams and Ginny Messina with that title. It's sold here also at the Bite Back stand. So yes, even vegans die. Vegans are not invincible, although we sometimes get the idea from all the health messages that we are. Sometimes there's also damage because of a chronic disease that cannot be reversed with a vegan diet. So chronic health shaming has proven to work counterproductive, possibly leading to depression, weight gain, and also addiction. So it can actually make people's health worse rather than motivate them to live a better lifestyle. And this also contributes to the idea that chronically ill vegans are not really good vegans, not good enough to stand on the barricades for veganism. If you don't fulfill the stereotypical image of beauty, of being young and healthy, you could scare people away, you know. You are not a good poster girl or boy for veganism. So being chronically ill myself, I have never really felt comfortable about opening up about my diseases in the vegan or animal rights community. And I know from fellow vegans who are chronically ill that they have had similar feelings because of the health shaming. So I often feel sandwiched in between these three remarks. On the one hand, I often feel outcasted from the vegan animal rights movement, portraying veganism as a miracle cure for all diseases. So that's what I talked about. And also alienating chronically ill vegans. On the other hand, I can also read the judgment in the heads of non-vegans when I tell them I'm vegan. So they look at me and they sometimes see me in a wheelchair and they say, oh, you're vegan, but you're not healthy. And then they will, of course, pinpoint my illness to not eating animals, and my veganism is to blame in their heads for not being healthy. And I would be cured if I just eat normal, so meaning animal products for them. And then on the other hand is also when the issue of diet is raised in, for example, support groups for chronically ill people, I'm very ambiguous about suggesting veganism as a diet. Do I also add that veganism is not a miracle cure? Because if it is such a miracle cure, how come I am still not cured? So those are, I often feel sandwiched in between those three, and I don't really know how to deal with that. There's also sometimes a very conflicting message in the vegan movement from organizations, and I must admit, I've also done this. I run a couple of pages, and sometimes I post a newspaper article that says, oh, look, plant-based diet, very healthy, and then the next day, I post a message about, oh, there's a new vegan burger, and we have new vegan ice cream full of sugar and fats and everything, so that's a very conflicting message. On the one hand, advertising veganism as a health message, and then the next day being excited about a new vegan cheese or hamburger. The pseudoscientific health advice that runs rampant in the vegan community, for example, the coconut oil cures everything. I'm sure you've read such statements. And also another thing that I see often is wishing bad health to non-vegans. For example, celebrating their death or them being ill. This was a newspaper article a couple of weeks ago about a British tourist who died in Greece after eating chicken because she had a food poisoning. Sorry. Now, sorry about the horrible photo of frostbite, but that is to make a point. The treatment of frostbite now is to gradually reheat the affected body parts with water between 37 degrees Celsius and 45 degrees Celsius. It used to be rubbing the body parts. It used to be rubbing the body parts, but now it's to gradually reheat these. And how do we know this? Because of experiments of a Japanese medical facility that ran during World War II and that did experiments, vivisection experiments on prisoners, on Chinese people mainly, but also prisoners of war. So throughout history, there have been several medical experiments on humans on which science has built. So we now have a body of knowledge because of those unethical experiments on humans. So I am against experiments on animals as much as I am against such experiments on humans who are violating human rights. But knowledge from the past cannot be unknown. We cannot undo the knowledge that has developed out of those experiments. Also the experiments that happened during World War II, the unethical experiments. So using or not using medication will in no way change the future. It does not alter the requirement for animal testing, which is mandatory by law. So even as if we as vegans all decide to stop taking medication, that will not change the fact that animal experiments will still continue. This is different than, for example, for cosmetics. There are alternatives for cosmetics, and we have a choice to buy products that are not tested. So we should focus on changing the legislation and developing alternatives for medication, and not on shaming vegans who do take medication. Another point to take into account to be an exclusive movement is, of course, being accessible. I'm thinking of accessibility of events, of demonstrations, of actions, of meetings, festivals, but also, for example, the accessibility of your website. So it's just not about wheelchair accessibility, but also, like I said before, provide image descriptions, subtitles, and so forth. And also, just as important, I feel, is provide information about the accessibility of an event or location. There's nothing as annoying as having to ask, over and over again if you want to go somewhere. Is it accessible? Are there any stairs? Do you have an accessible toilet? So if you organize an event, have a separate page where you put some information about the accessibility, where you put a contact person who can be reached if people have questions about accessibility. And don't have the attitude, oh, we'll just wait and see if somebody asks information about being accessible, and then we'll think about it and how we're going to deal with it. Think about it in advance, before you organize the event. Be inclusive. Inclusiveness is more than just diversity. It's not because some persons with a disability participate in your event or because some older people are a member of an organization that the event or organization is truly diverse or inclusive. So also don't use people with disabilities or older people as tokens in campaigns or on images. I'm going to round up now, okay? So why is this important to address ableism and ageism? On the one hand, of course, for effective activism. As a movement, we must try to reach everyone in society. We must build bridges. If people don't feel welcome in our movement, we're missing out on a whole group of people. And of course, which I think is the core of the animal rights movement is a justice movement. And ableism and ageism and all the other forms of discrimination and oppression go against the principle of fairness and compassion for all. And I would like to end with a very fitting and well-known quote from Audre Lorde. She was a Black feminist writer and feminist activist. And although she did not specifically address speciesism, I feel it is appropriate here as it underlines the interconnectedness of all oppressions. So it goes like this. The master's tools will never dismantle the master's house. They may allow us to beat him at his own game, but they will never enable us to bring about genuine change. So racism, sexism, ableism, and ageism, and other forms of oppression and discrimination are the master's tools, and so is speciesism. And if you want to bring down the speciesist house, we cannot do so by using oppressive tools of discrimination based on age, gender, race, sexual orientation, or abilities. And I feel it's high time that the movement does some introspection on all of these issues. Okay, thank you.
Thank you for watching my presentation on ableism and ageism and speciesism. So I have a question for you. Do you think that disabled people and older people have a place in the movement? Do you think they are good for being on the cover of a magazine, to be a face of the vegan movement, of the animal rights movement? Or do you think it's better, it's more effective, if disabled people and older people take a step back? So I'm interested in hearing your opinions on this. Please leave a comment on the video. Bye.